Dr. Pepper kickoff weekend continues here on ABC in prime time as the new head coaches at Notre Dame and Pitt go head to head. Dave Wannstedt and Charlie Weiss returning to their alma mater. Some of you will see Texas A&M on the road to face the Clemson Tigers, who are painted up and ready to go to take on the Aggies.
In South Carolina, home of Death Valley, and the place where visiting teams often die. In this 2005 season, the Tigers will rely on a rejuvenated Charlie Whitehurst to keep them in the race in a new and improved ACC. Clemson hopes that last year's strong finish will carry them to a big start this year. The Aggies of Texas A&M will be led by one of the most dynamic players in all of college football, quarterback Reggie McNeil. Last year, McNeil led A&M to their best season since 01. And the goal for the Aggies team, take the next step in one of the toughest conferences in the game. 17th-ranked Texas A&M takes on the Clemson Tigers. A great opening matchup right now on ABC.
Football kickoff weekend on ABC. 17th ranked Texas A&M preseason looking to take on the Clemson Tigers, who are looking for an upset in game one, and they get Texas A&M at home. One of the great traditions in college football is right here at Clemson. They touch the rock at the top of the hill, and then they run down to the field with 78,000 roaring. That's how Clemson makes their appearance. That's the way it's been for a long time. For Texas A&M, a more quiet start. Coach Dennis Franchione talking to his players before the game in the dressing room. A very big game for them. Welcome, everybody. Delighted to have you with us. Great day of college football underway here. I'm Gary Thorne. Ed Cunningham, Susie Schuster will be joining us down on the field. And for our game here, we get to see two quarterbacks who are going to make or are not going to make a huge difference for each of these teams.
And both of them have made huge differences in the last couple of years. Unfortunately for Charlie Whitehurst, he made a bad difference last year. Reggie McNeil, a great year last year. Charlie Whitehurst back in 2003 had people talking about possibly a first-round draft pick. He was just a sophomore. His dad, David, played in the NFL for the Green Bay Packers. Last year, when everything went south for Clemson offensively, 100th in the country in rushing, the quarterback went south as well. 17 interceptions against 7 touchdowns. The very opposite thing happened for Reggie McNeil. An awful year for the team at Texas A&M in 03 with only 4 wins, 8 touchdowns, 7 interceptions, dedicated himself, and with a lack of running game last year, Courtney Lewis was not 100%. It all fell on his shoulders. An amazing year. Texas A&M record, 2,791 yards. If he improves on that this year, come November, I think we're going to be talking about the Heisman race for Mr. McNeil.
One of the interesting things of a game one always is you never know what the heck you're going to get down there in the field, so the coaches' hearts are beating just like the players. Susie Schuster.
Of course they are. Gary Thorne. Let me ask you, Coach Bowden, you've got a new offensive coordinator in Rob Spence for your senior quarterback. How concerned are you for him tonight?
Well, I'm not really concerned. I mean, Charlie's a fifth-year senior. I don't think they can throw much at him that'll really shock him. They might throw a new wrinkle. They've had the whole summer to prepare, but I think Charlie will recover well if they do.
You started last season 1-4. How important is it for you guys to start out there fast tonight?
Well, it's a long season, tough conference schedule. It's an important game, but it's not the whole season.
Thanks very much. Gary?
All right, Susie, thanks very much. And thanks to the coach for taking time to be with us here. Because obviously, at this point, there's a lot that they are thinking about. Coach Fran, on the other side, you have to be a little worried about this football game. You know you are favored in this game, for better or worse, but the problem is you're playing at a very tough location here in Death Valley. Third season with Texas A&M. They hope that maybe this is the year in the division with Texas and Oklahoma that maybe it's Texas A&M at the top.
And Ed, what happened today has got to be a great spur for them with the loss of Oklahoma took.
Well, and Coach Franchione told us yesterday, he said, you know, to play in the top of the Big 12 South, you have to be in the top five in the country, because that's where Texas and Oklahoma usually reside. And shocking game today. Texas finally beat Oklahoma. Unfortunately, it was Texas Christian.
Yeah, that's right. Clemson won. They have deferred to the second half. So Texas A&M is going to be receiving. We are ready to go. The crowd's up. It is a beautiful night here in Clemson. Kick will be taken deep into the end zone. In fact, out of it. And Jason Carter decides, maybe I'll just let that one go. And that's what he does. So we're underway. We'll start from the 20-yard line, first and 10. I won't have any trouble telling Texas A&M in the generally white uniforms with the brown numerals and the orange, which is everywhere to be seen here. And for Reggie McNeil, the only returning quarterback in college football to pass for more than 220 yards per game and rush for more than 50. He is a great double threat.
Probably the best running throwing combination quarterback in all of college football. Vince Young at Texas, of course, amazing. Had the great game against Michigan in the Rose Bowl. But this guy is, he's really improved his accuracy as well. That's what all of his receivers were talking about yesterday when we were speaking with them.
Courtney Lewis is a tremendous runner in the backfield who suffered through injuries last year. Keep an eye on him. Going straight up the middle to Lewis. It'll be interesting to see how much they use him. He had 9 starts last year. Charles Bennett put the tackle on. Keep an eye on what we're going to see. Texas A&M, their backs and receivers. Of course, you're going to be looking at Jason Carter, a great wide receiver. He will get used a lot in this game. And on the offensive line, veterans here. Yoder, he will key, working out of that center position as to how the blocking goes. It'll be a second down and a 10. No gain right there on the 20. Fakes it, looking. He wants to go deep. They're going to try the bomb at midfield. That is going to be... A flag is down. It's incomplete. Nope, no flag picked up. No flag, and it is incomplete. Great pressure put on by Gaines Adams, who is the new bandit, and he put some good pressure on right here.
Well, a new offensive coordinator for Tommy Bowden, and also a new defensive coordinator. Vic Koenig comes from Troy, the old head coach from out in Wyoming, and he said, I am so afraid of these guys getting behind us. That time, Texas A&M had 3 guys running deep. Jamal Fudge, the rest of the safeties, way back. There was nowhere to go.
5 receivers as they will work this out of the shotgun. A third down and a 10. Reggie McNeil goes back, standing at his own 15-yard line. No rush on. They're going to put coverage. Sideline wide open at the 40. Up to the 45 and near midfield. Daquan Mobley, who started 11 games last year. Reggie McNeil, a 28-yard gain.
Well, these are two roommates, Mobley and Reggie McNeil, live together off campus. The cornerback squats and the safety does not get over the top. That's a good job. C.J. Gaddis, who has as much ability as anybody on the field, a former cornerback. Coach Koenig said he was a little concerned about him knowing his assignments, had to beg him to go to safety during the spring, and that time he did not get over the top fast enough.
That is a big early play. A third down and a 10 from their own 20, and they move the ball all the way up to the 49-yard line. He can run, he can pitch, makes the pitch near side and out of bounds at about the 48. Good job by the defense as Courtney Lewis took the pitch and they spread him out with Tremaine Billy over there to put the hit on. This defensive line, Gain Adams, tremendous tackler. He is the new man who goes in that bandit position. You've seen him already. He's got to have a big day, and this is a tough game to start in when you're moving to that new position. Their secondary's tough. Ty Hill, we'll talk a lot about him today. He's a great defender. So bring up a second down and a 7. Ball is now in Clemson territory. Again, it'll be Mobley and Carter, the receivers. There are 5 of them. Over the top, near side, 40, up to the 35, the 30, down to the 20, and to the 10-yard line, out of bounds, Jason Carter, the senior wide receiver, on a big gain and another first down. 38 yards. Wow, has that quieted the house?
Well, and Daquan Mobley, we saw him earlier run through. And as we start this play, you're going to see number 9. Jason Carter is tackled. Watch the block. Finish the play on Ty Hill. He didn't get a good block. And then he absorbs the safety coming over, which is Jamal Fudge. That's twice now that the safeties for Clemson have taken bad angles or not come up in the proper pursuit. Vic Koenig's worst nightmare now coming true.
It is a first down and 10. Ball is spotted at the 33-yard line on the step out of bounds. Otherwise, it would have been down at the 10-yard line. Run it out of the backfield. Try to go wide. One missed tackle, but not the second one. Maybe a gain of one on that as C.J. Gattis got in there and put the hit on. Gattis with a good tackle. And again, at least early on, we're seeing the Clemson defense string out these wide plays.
Well, they've got plenty of speed. What was really concerning for Tommy Bowden was the size matchup they were giving up. Donnell Clark got through that time. He goes 265 pounds. You showed that offensive line, only one guy under 300 pounds. Courtney Lewis did a good job, but they definitely have plenty of speed. A lot of undersized kind of former safeties at linebacker.
What a spread offense. McNeil brings the man in motion back. Courtney Lewis. Four receivers. Lewis in the backfield is another one. He fakes to him. He knew will carry up inside the 30, 25. He can fly 20, 15 and knocked out of bounds at about the 13-yard line. And that's the double danger of Reggie McNeil, who picks up 19.
You know, there's a lot of defensive coordinators in this country that if they ever got a chance to meet up with Urban Meyer, who's now down in Florida, they'd thank him for making this, and I say that facetiously, for making this type of play so popular. Of course, last year, Utah goes undefeated with Alex Smith, and that is that handoff where the defense, they have to respect the running back first, and then you've got a guy who runs a 4.28 40, taking it around the end. The defensive end bites inside, and it's almost like an underneath option.
All right, they'll put two wide receivers, send the man in motion. Lewis still in the backfield. Again, the option play. McNeil's going to carry, looks, flips it. Lewis got it to the end zone. Touchdown! Wow. Flag down.
Yeah, that's a good call. It was a late call, but they had to call Joey Thomas the tight end. No question about it.
Going to bring that one back.
Joey Thomas came in motion, the tight end, and as the defender was trying to go outside, I believe he was going against the outside linebacker, Tremaine Billy.
Holding call will nullify the touchdown and move the ball back.
Holding, 81 of the offense, 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
Here's the penalty.
Joey Thomas right here, you'll see him out. And wow, what a nice job by Tremaine Billy. He has contained. And Tremaine Billy just did a wonderful job of inside hand leverage. And that's actually a mental break by Thomas. If he gets outside, just try to wash him. Don't grab it.
Clemson being tested early here. First down 15, ball at the 18-yard line. They've got Taylor in as a wide receiver. A fumble. It's dropped and recovered by A&M. And there was a lot of room on the near side. That ball just ended up being a little too greasy.
Well, and this is exactly what Tommy Bowden said needed to happen early in the season. You know, Susie asked him earlier about early in the season winning the game, and he kind of downplayed it. This is a huge game for Tommy Bowden. And the biggest problem they had last year during that 1-4 stop, they were dead last in the NCAA in turnovers. They were minus four in the game against Texas A&M, and the holding call and then the fumble, things going a little better for them early.
All right, we've got a second down and 19. Chris Alexander has come into the fullback position. They go out of the H now in a shotgun. Handoff is going to be straight up the middle. It'll be taken to about the 17-yard line. That's Alexander, the sophomore running back in at fullback, who carries. They lost the touchdown on the penalty, and now we'll be faced with a third and long. But in great field position as Alexander comes out.
And as we talk about turnovers, the one thing that Dennis Franchione said, because Reggie McNeil only threw four interceptions last year and only threw one during all of camp, they'll call anything. I think a good play here might be with his 4.28 speed. You've got the wide side to his throwing side, his right side. Get him out. Give him a run pass option.
Third and 14. Chad Schroeder's come in as a wide receiver as they put two left, two right, and send the back in motion. Out of the shotgun, McNeil looking over the middle into the end zone. That is incomplete and almost intercepted. He went straight down the gut on that one, trying to find someone cutting through. Mobley, the wide receiver, but it wasn't even close. So Clemson holds and gets a break on the penalty.
A lot of size in orange right now.
Pretty good offensive thrust. You see what A&M throws up against you.
Yeah, and you go back to that holding call, just a mental bust by Thomas. No reason to do that at that point.
Todd Pegram will be on to do the kicking. 12 out of 13 last year in field goals. 41 for 56 in his career. This is going to be a 35-yard attempt
for Texas A&M on the 4th and 14. Ball down, Pegram up, got the foot into it, and that one is through. So A&M does not come away empty-handed as Pegram gets the field goal, and he's a good one. He is very accurate. And on their first offensive drive, they go up 3-0 over Clemson. What a beautiful sight. Aerial coverage for tonight's game, courtesy of the Outback Steakhouse Airship, the Bloomin' Onion One Outback Steakhouse Airship, specializing in college football and PGA golf experience. Look for the Bloomin' Onion at sports events throughout the year. Great to have you with us, guys. And what a night to be up there. What a night to be here. We thank you for joining us. And A&M for Clemson, actually, you got to feel as though on that first one, Ed, that they actually won that, giving up only three.
That looked awfully easy for the Aggies. And you just see the pressure that Reggie McNeil puts on. They talked, you know, when we talked to Reggie earlier about those underneath handoffs, he said we've always had that in the offense. But Texas A&M coaches went to Utah, visited with them, and they've just started to emphasize that part of the game a little bit more.
It'll be Coleman and Gattis back to take this kickoff from A&M. Richie Bean, who's their new kicker. He's only a freshman. We'll be hearing about him this year. Puts the foot into that one, and that's going to be taken right at the end line to the 10. Coleman, and he's not going to get up to that 20-yard line as the ball loosens up, but they still got it. Let's check in with John Saunders. John.
Gary, with the Taco Bell update, USC at Hawaii. Reggie Bush shows why he was in New York at the Heisman Trophy finalists last year. Great speed, 41 yards is a touchdown run there. USC also has an interception return for a touchdown. 21-3 is their lead near the end of the first half. Gary.
All right, John, thanks. That's why they're number one.
Yeah, Reggie Bush actually got faster and stronger this summer. It's kind
Yikes.
Of scary.
Yeah.
Charlie Whitehurst will be at quarterback. There he is, hoping to have a kind of recovery year. Not a bad year last year, but not the one he wanted. Davis is back in the backfield. We'll see four running backs in and out of this lineup. He had eight up at the line of scrimmage, and that's why they were looking for the run, and A&M got that one right and takes it down. Chris Harrington moved in to put the tackle on. Take a look at some of the players we're going to see. Reggie Merriweather, keep an eye on him as a running back. He will make a very big difference in this game if he can stay healthy this year. Should have a good one. The line, Dustin Fry, he makes the calls in the middle for the offensive line at center.
And this offensive line, a lot different. Rob Spence comes in from Toledo. They'll work out of a two-point stance all night, never put their hand down. A lot of zone blocking.
Second and 11, little flare out to the near side. 15, 20, there's a lot of room to the 31 man to beat, and knocked out of bounds near the 40. Chansi Stuckey, a junior wide receiver, gets 24 yards on a first down.
This is one of those things, you know, the coaches always talk about the first game. They say, you know, I've seen the enemy and it's me. A lot of missed tackles. That time, Ronald Jones just does not break down. For all intents and purposes, that should have been about a 3-yard loss. But Chansi Stuckey makes a little move and Ronald Jones ducks his head. And that's why it ends up being a big game instead of a short loss.
We'll see how the tight ends come to play here. This Clemson offense, that's one of the issues for the defensive teams against them early. They're going to use tight ends. They did not last year. They're supposed to be a big part of their offense. They got two wide receivers out here straight up the middle. That'll be taken up to the 40, and a hard second effort. We'll move it over the 40. That is Reggie Merriweather we were talking about. Reggie Merriweather can run. That'll be a challenge for the defensive line. Red Bryant, one of their leading tacklers, he'll be in on a lot of it here today. Look at the linebacker positions. Justin Warren, he's their leading tackler in a linebacker position. The secondary, very tough, none more so than Jackson Appel.
We'll run through his injury list.
Appel, we haven't gotten all night, you know.
He actually, one of his injuries is actually shown in the sports medicine clinic as an example of a dislocated elbow. Rather gruesome.
Thank you so much. Merriweather on the handoff. Jackson was in the backfield trying to get up to the 45, actually slipped a little bit trying to get back on that one and is taken down. That is Jason Jack out of Humble, Texas, who moved in and put the hit on.
And right away you see what this new offense is going to be. You know, anybody who'd seen Toledo, and of course a lot of people got to see Rob Spence's Toledo Rocket offense because they used to play on that ESPN Thursday night game a lot. And that was actually, I think, why Tommy Bowden went in getting him. But it's a little, you think it's, you know, a lot of short screens and things, but really it's based in the power zone running game. And that's what Tommy Bowden just had to get back to try to help out Charlie Whitehurst in his senior year.
A&M converted on a big third down play at their own 20. Can Clemson do it here? Third down and three. Ball spotted at the 43-yard line. A lot of movement, no flags. Going straight up the middle, very close to a first down. very close. That's Reggie Merriweather. Well, we'll go on the spot on this one.
I don't think he got it. No, they get it. That's the old right-footed spot.
Listen, when you're a fullback running like that, nothing's given to you. Come on. You offensive linemen ought to be giving it to the backs. You're the guys leading charge.
My old high school coach, you say, give no quarter, take no quarter. I still have no idea what that means, but he said it a lot.
And it sounds good.
Yes, it does.
And it's a good adage.
And it got you fired up.
All right, first down and 10. They do indeed convert on that one. Merriweather stays in the backfield, number 37. They'll work out of the shotgun again. Charlie Whitehurst, wide receivers each way. Whitehurst can throw it. Merriweather can run it, and he does, trying to get to midfield. Maybe a gain of one on that. Archie McDaniel, the rover, moved in to put the hit on.
All right, can I give a little O-lineman critique early on?
Always.
Well, you know, this offensive line for Clemson goes from basically kind of a one-on-one trap blocking scheme last year. Now they're going to zone blocking, where I've got the A gap, you've got the B gap, we've got the C gap, and you just work your way out. Right now, they don't have their angles right. This is the first time in live action against a team other than their own where you kind of get used to them. They're not used to the speed of Texas A&M defense, and they're missing. Their angles are just not right. They're not getting any push off the line of scrimmage.
Kyle Browning has come in, second down and 9. Again, a jump. This time there is a flag down. Flag down on this play, and it'll be behind the scrimmage where the tackle is made. But we'll wait and see what the call is here as Kyle Browning was there on the carry. We've had a lot of movement on long counts in the last two plays for Clemson's put on.
Unfortunately, sometimes it's you. Not that time.
Well, no one's going to be on the fence. Well, Coach Bud, the question is, what do you want to get done offensively in this game if you're Clemson? And he said,
Biggest thing is running game. We got to fix the running game. I don't know if it's ever going to look pretty, but again, the running game, I think, for us to be successful offensively and as a team, I think we need to be productive in that area. And it takes a lot of pressure off the offensive lineman and drop back passing mode when you do have to do that. So I don't know if it'd be pretty, but it needs to be productive.
An efficient running game, meaning now you've got second and 3.5, second and almost 4. You got to pick up 4 yards. It doesn't have to be 15 or 20 yards, and it doesn't have to look like, you know, the hole doesn't have to be 15 yards wide. It just has to be efficient. When you need it, it's got to pay off.
Now we're seeing another change. You see Merriweather probably changing it up. Last year that wouldn't have happened like that. He would have looked at the sideline. He would have gotten it from the sideline. He has those decisions this year, and a pretty good one right there.
Well,
carry
nice
straight
cut
up by Kyle Browning through the middle, close to a first down, but he may not have gotten that one.
Boy, that was a really nice cut.
And twice we saw Charlie Whitehurst come out from under and talk both ways.
Well, what had happened over the last couple of years was Clemson had gone to a offense where they'd run up to the line of scrimmage, never huddle. They'd call the play, and then the coaches would change it. That has changed. There's not 10 or 15 plays. Tommy said they now have chicken or steak. You pick one or the other. And it will make Charlie Whitehurst a better quarterback as he surveys the defense. Before, he could just wait for the call to come from upstairs. Now it's on him.
Kyle Browning has come in. This is going to be a first down and 10, so they're moving it a bit here. This is what they wanted to do. That'll be carried to the line of scrimmage and maybe a yard if lucky, but Archie McDaniel again came in and put the hit on, and a good hard crunch put on Kyle Browning. We'll see Browning, Dwayne Coleman, and James Davis all in and out of that running back position along with Reggie Merriweather today.
And the one thing, Rob Spence, you can see already, the thing, he's always working, changing personnel in and out, in and out. The entire offense turns. Who's coming in? What personnel grouping are we in? And they're going to try to use the H-back slash tight end to get involved. Obviously, in the shotgun, be some kind of draw if you do it at all.
You see, they're not huddling. They're coming to the line here in these plays. Whitehurst is in the shotgun on a 2nd and 9 at the 41-yard line. Whitehurst looking on the hook on the right. Gets hit. Gets it away. Incomplete. On the near side, would have been out of bounds. Anyway, Dwayne Coleman coming out of the backfield, the intended receiver, and that will bring up a 3rd down and 9. Delighted to have you with us. What a day of football it has been. The big upset Oklahoma today. We'll keep you posted on all the scores of this afternoon and games going on tonight. With Ed Cunningham and Susie Schuster, I'm Gary Thorne. Early drive put on by Texas A&M. They're ranked 17th preseason and favored in this game. But this Clemson Tiger team, no one quite sure exactly what they're going to look like this year with a new offensive and defensive coordinator. They're 1-for-1 third down conversions. Here's another 3rd down and 9, and everybody's moving.
You know, they just don't seem, I mean, they've moved the ball okay. They've got a couple of nice little plays in there, but they just don't, it seems like a first game.
Prior to the snap, false start, 74 of the offense, 5 yards, still 3rd down.
And this was the biggest problem. for Clemson last year, and Tommy Bowden talked a lot about, we've got to change the launch point for Charlie. Where does he throw it from? You know, they spent all season in third, 8, 9, 10 plus. Well, that's easy for the defense to figure out. The quarterback like Whitehurst, it's going to be a 5 or 7 step drop. Quarterback, the defensive line knows where to rush, and now they're right back to that spot.
He was a 50% completion rate quarterback last year. Not good. They've got a 3rd down and 14 here. They're obviously trying to establish the running game first and throw off that. Obviously here, looking to throw. 2 receivers near side, 3 total, couple back. Whitehurst gets tackled, and down he goes, trying to get rid of the football, and did. It'll be an incomplete pass, but that was Justin Warren, who we talked about as a potential to be an all Big 12 player, putting the heat on.
Well, and Carl Torbush, the defensive coordinator, 3rd and long, goes in like a 3-3 stack look. And you end up with 5 guys rushing, a twist in the middle. And Justin Warren just did a good job of coming around the left guard to get there to finish. Wow. Whitehurst lucky to get that off.
Cole Chason will come out to do the kicking, averaged 40.2 yards last season. Back is Jordan Chambliss at the 10-yard line for Texas A&M on a 4th down and 14. Almost over his head. Pretty good rush put on as well. He's trying to get the roll on that one, but instead it goes out of bounds. He shanked that one off to the right. So Texas A&M will take it over at about the, well, we'll see. Looks like it's going to be the 28-yard line. They kept walking up. Texas A&M early on has the 3-0 lead over Clemson, the opener for these two here on ABC. The Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend on ABC, brought to you by Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Dr. Pepper, one taste and you get it. Chevy, the new Chevrolets, an American revolution. Outback Steakhouses, no rules, just right. And Capital One, what's in your wallet?
At $7.
If it looks like normal, there's probably nothing in it.
And some lint.
That's some lint. Yeah, Texas A&M, Coach Fran over there. Cool, calm, as he usually is.
He does not. He walks into the meeting and he's just, hey guys, nice to see you.
Life is good.
Yeah.
Courtney Lewis is in the backfield. Reggie McNeil, Texas A&M, their offense, 1st and 10 at the 29-yard line. Work out of the H on the fake and the pitch. And boy, there's a hole over there. 30, 35, and that's going to be enough for a 1st down. It is very tough to do much with those plays when they run like that. That is Kerry Franks, Jason Carter, rather, a wide receiver on the carry.
Well, Carter's a guy that they've used, a senior, and every year for the last 3 years, he's had at least one pass attempt, at least one rush attempt, at least one punt return, and at least one kick return, and at least one reception. It's first guy ever in the Big 12 to do that 3 years in a row. So they'll move him all over. What they're trying to set up there, Gary, is they'll have an option pass. At some point, if the safeties start coming down too fast, Carter, a former high school quarterback, throw it down the field.
There he is back in the backfield jogging there. This time they go straight up the middle. Boy, you've got to be sure on your tackles because you're doing a lot of juking up there. That's Courtney Lewis, their leading running back. Tremaine Billy moved in to put the hit on the junior. You see all the movement, huh, that Texas has going on in the backfield all the time?
And here's the scary part for when you're trying to defend A&M and going through. Kirk Herbstreit actually said he thinks A&M has a shot at the Big 12 South, and I happen to agree with him.
Especially
we saw today Oklahoma, but the reason is a healthy Courtney Lewis. He had a high ankle sprain. He's 100% now, and he put on 10 pounds during the offseason, kept all of his speed.
5 receivers. McNeil out of the shotgun, 2nd down and 7 at the 43. They got a couple flying on the near side. He's got a ton of room. There's nobody but one blocker to the 40 and will take it out of bounds. I mean, there was nothing but daylight down that side. Reggie McNeil, a 19-yard gain, and he's having a big running game.
Well, you can't lose contain. If your defensive end's going to come inside, somebody's got to replace him, especially, listen, this guy runs a 4.28 40. Well, oh, the linebacker just made a terrible mistake. That was Anthony Waters. He's got to finish his rush. The defensive end came down inside. Waters was supposed to replace him. It's not even a blitz. It's still just rushing 4. You've got to stay on your assignment against a guy like McNeil. McNeil, you have to keep your lanes.
Here he is again. Takes a big hit, but got rid of the football. And good coverage on the near side. A flag goes down. But the tackle made it about the 38-yard line by C.J. Gaddis again. Let's see what the flag is as Courtney Lewis was on the carry. Talking about McNeil, last year, these two teams played. Texas A&M won it 27-6. He had his best total offensive day of the year as McNeil went 307 total yards in that game.
Rushed for 129 yards on just 17 carries. First thing Coach Bowden said on our conference call this week.
Incidental face mask. Number 20 of the defense. 5 yards from the end of the run. Repeat first down.
First thing out of Tommy Bowden's mouth about this year was, yeah, we probably need to do a better job tackling their quarterback. It's like master of the obvious, but it's true.
Not very easy to
do, though.
There's
not many people. And, you know, as the year wore on and he got more comfortable in this offense, he had 8 200-yard passing games or more to finish the season. So he started to not run as much, and he's becoming a much better pocket passer.
He didn't like what he saw there and asked for the timeout. Reggie McNeil, that's who we're talking about, listed in by many as a candidate or at least a dark horse when you're talking about the Heisman. He'll go over to try and set it up. It'll be a first down at 4 when we come back. First quarter, Texas A&M early field goal leading 3-0. You're watching Dr. Pepper's College Football Kickoff Weekend here on ABC. And Clemson is the site, and a glorious one it is for football fans. 3-0. We've got a first down and 4. Texas A&M, McNeil with the football. McNeil wanted to go pitch, comes back the other way. McNeil, they're trying to find him. He's surrounded by Orange, and down he goes. Well, that's called aggressive tackling, and following him one way and then the other as Donnell Clark and Jock McKissick in on the tackle.
The guy that all of the coaches have been talking about at Clemson is number 20, Jermaine Billy. He wears that number because of old Brian Dawkins, now with the Philadelphia Eagles, a former Clemson Tiger. But Jermaine Billy was the AAA state 100-meter champion in the state of South Carolina, originally committed to South Carolina as a running back. They put him at outside linebacker. And Coach Koenig said, if there's one guy I want chasing number one around, it's number 20.
This is a second down and 6. They lost 2. There's the flip. Here's the option play. Man open end zone. And it is incomplete. Wide open was Daquan Mobley. This is one of the halfback option plays. It was Jason Carter who ended up throwing it.
Carter is going to have nightmares about this. Mobley couldn't have been more open. 15, 20 yards. The safeties are starting to suck down. Les Koenig, the offensive coordinator for Texas A&M, sees the safeties having to play. It's a javelin throw. As a former quarterback, he's got a little better form than that. Well, and the receiver might want to catch it when it hits him in the hands, too.
Yeah, had a real chance on that.
Still underthrown, though.
Another big third down play, third down and 6. Ball at the 34-yard line. 5 receivers again. Quick look into the left. Incomplete at the 25-yard line. It would have been a first down. That was not held onto by Kerry Franks. That's a play you got to catch.
Well, that's two badly thrown balls in a row, but when it hits guys in the hands, that ball was thrown behind Kerry Franks and a little high. But he's got to make this catch. This is a first down if he makes that catch. And it was Mobley before. 2 drops in a row, and now you're looking like into a punting formation, although
we'll see.
No, Reggie McNeil still in there.
Like they're going to go.
I really like this call by Dennis Franchione.
3:42 to go.
Absolutely
first
love this.
It
on
is
the
a
road.
4th and 6 at the 34-yard line. They're going to go for it. McNeil, 4th down conversion. He's going to try and take it. Flag is down. It'll be incomplete, but hang on for the flag.
Well, they're going to have holding over on the right side.
So keep that one in mind. First quarter. 4th and 6. Texas A&M went for it, and they get called on the hold.
I still like it, though. You give the ball over on the 34-yard line. Clemson, the offense moved it a little bit, but struggled there at the end.
Holding. Number 81 of the offense. Penalties decline. First down.
So it's turned over. And we're going to check in with John Saunders. John.
Gary, with the singular All-America Player of the Week update, you might want to vote for this guy. DJ Shockley ran one in for a touchdown and threw for 5. Text the word vote to 87654 now on your singular phone for your ballot and a chance to win a trip to the national championship game. Your singular Player of the Week update, Gary.
All right, John, thanks very much. John keeping us up to date on what's going on tonight and also what happened this afternoon. Clemson gets the football, trailing 3-0 on the early field goal that Texas A&M got on their first drive. First down and 10. Whitehurst under center this time and a flag on a move.
Well, this is offensive line from Clemson. Brad Scott, the coach, needs to get them settled down, focused. For some reason, they're lacking focus.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 75 in the offense. 5 yards, still first down.
Think this is a combination of first game and changed offense?
Yeah, I think so. You know, one thing, they changed all of the terminology. They also changed their cadence a little bit. It's different than what they had last year, but you've got to think through spring, 29 practices a fall. This is killing Tommy Bowden because this is just small, tiny stuff that you work on every single day. That's how you start practice with get-offs and counts and things like that.
Davis is in the backfield, three receivers out the other way. Whitehurst with a first down and 15 now. Ball at a 29-yard line. Lewis will come back up the middle. Got some room. He can go at the 40, 45, up the midfield. Going deep into A&M territory. A great run. Jackson Appel moved in, but I'm telling you, James Davis just gained 33 yards up the middle.
True freshman, probably the biggest recruit Tommy Bowden has ever signed. From right down the road in Atlanta, Georgia, rushed for almost 8,000 yards in his high school career. Had a little homesickness at camp, went home for a couple of days, came back. He had more carries in all of the scrimmages than any other back. And you can hear the electricity of the fans because they have been waiting to see this young man.
A couple of tight ends will move in to the offense. Downer and Williamson are both in there now. Whitehurst again quickly going to send a man in motion left side. That's Williamson in motion. Again, will go straight up the middle and maybe a gain of a yard.
Douglas High School, Atlanta, Georgia. James Davis. I think a new offensive coordinator going to a more zone-based running attack really helped recruit this young man. Everybody in the country wanted him. 5'11", 210 pounds. Obviously dominated in high school, but you could see his size in his lower body. He's got to start carrying the ball closer in, a little higher in his pads, because he was, you could see there in high school, he kind of had it out there flashing it around, and he had some fumbles early, and that will get him off the field. He's got to learn how to take care of the ball.
Merriweather, the only one back. Only three passes have been thrown so far by Charlie Whitehurst. Now he looks back. He's got three going to the end zone, near side. A little pushing and shoving, and there goes the flag.
No, he threw the beanie. There comes the flag. There you go.
There was going to be a flag as Ronald Jones was back on Curtis Bayham. He spotted it first with a bag and then got the flag up. That's what he did.
He grabbed the wrong thing.
Want to give him credit. There you see the call. It is defensive pass interference.
He felt something scrunchy in his belt and he threw it. And it ended up being a beanie bag for a fumble instead of a flag, because this is obviously pass interference. Bayham does a nice job. And the problem, Ronald Jones has position. He leans on him and he alters the route. If he'd have just left his hand out there, he'd have been fine.
Big play. That's a big play. So there's the fourth pass thrown, only the fourth thrown by Charlie Whitehurst here in this first half, first quarter. And interesting of how they've gone to the running game, running, running, running.
We kind of had that feeling. We were talking about it last night in our production meeting that Tommy Bowden did not bring in Rob Spence from Toledo to not run the ball. I mean, that was the whole reason they wanted to get some type of power. Doesn't have to be pretty, but he wanted some type of downhill running game.
First and 10 at the 22-yard line. Merriweather is back in at the running back position. The 5'8 tank. And a timeout's going to be taken as Merriweather looks up and Charlie Whitehurst wants to come over and talk about it. 2:17 left to go here in the first quarter, and an early field goal by Texas A&M has given them the lead, but Clemson threatening. Number 17 preseason Texas A&M. They are up early in this game, but after that first great drive, they've kind of cut it down.
There's Rob Spence, came in from Toledo. Unbelievable success as the offensive coordinator. Pretty good company he was in last year. 2,000 rush, 3,000 pass.
Yikes.
Yeah, those were all the best offenses in the nation, and Toledo was one of them.
Clemson in great field position here. It'll be a first down at 10. Let's see how he plays it. They did have time to talk about it here. Merriweather still in the backfield. Whitehurst, quarterback, still looking down, waiting for the clearance to go. While we have a moment, I'll just remind you, this year replays are in effect for any calls on the field falling within the rules. We haven't had any of that here in the first yet. Looking for the flanker, left side, 15, down near the first down marker. Trying to stack it up over there. That was Aaron Kelly, number 80, on the reception, and had some blockers in front of him. Thursday night, ABC starts the football season with a spectacular celebration. The Rolling Stones, Green Day, Santana, many more. They'll be on stage. NFL opening kickoff presented by Sprint. And then Tom Brady, Super Bowl champion Patriots, take on Randy Moss, the Raiders. Monday Night Football, a special edition. Thursday night at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC.
It's a little confusing. It's on Thursday night, right?
Don't ask me to do that again. It's Monday Night Football on Thursday, okay? You can handle that.
I got it.
All right, this is a second down now and one. Second and one. Merriweather, Harnell in the backfield. They're going to go for that first down, and they're going to get it and more inside the 10, up to about the 7. That's Reggie Merriweather.
You know, this Clemson crowd, anybody older than about 32, 33 years old, remembers the days when the offensive lineman from Clemson couldn't see about 2 feet in front of them because their butt was so high up in the ground, in the air, and they were just firing off cut block and running the option. They're going to go back to a little bit of that now. A little more power running. There was nothing pretty about that. That was right in the A gap to the left of the center with a little tiny trap. There's nothing gorgeous about it, but very effective.
Whitehurst going to the left side this time, and not much gain on that one. That's Johnny Jolly for Texas A&M. Defensive tackle who's a third year starter moved in and put the hit on Merriweather, had nowhere to go. So they stack it up, under a minute left to go here in the quarter. You see, look at the players look.
Yeah.
Just so we'll talk about this. Clemson, after every play, all the players turn to the sideline. That's where the play call is coming from.
I've always been a fan of huddling.
Yeah.
I just am. I think the quarterback should call the play in a huddle. They have a check with me, and we've seen it. It's already, they're just not used to it yet. They may get used to it week three or week four, but they are not used to it right now.
Whitehurst goes to the shotgun. Two receivers near side. It is second and goal from the 8-yard line. Clock ticking at 18 seconds. They load it up on the right side. Got to get rid of it. Dawes just throws it away. Had nobody open here on the short side of the field. 13 left on the clock.
Well, whenever you get the first and goal from the 9, that's such a difficult place to call plays. They ran a little inside run, got nothing. And so now second and goal from the 9. Here comes the plays. They have about 15 people. One of those guys is the hot guy.
Tough for A&M to make their defensive changes here because Clemson is not huddling.
Well, I think what you have to do is just rotate to keep people fresh. Don't worry. It's okay. You can walk a linebacker occasionally out to cover. But now, advantage Texas A&M because they know Whitehurst is going to have to throw this.
Coleman has now come into the backfield. A third down and goal from the 8-yard line. Whitehurst again on the pitch up the middle on the draw to the near side 5 and the 4. And that's where he'll be stopped. And that is Dwayne Coleman, the junior. One of those four running backs, Jackson Appel, who makes big tackles, makes another one.
Really nice call by Rob Spence. He knew he was going to get a blitz. Just you had to know that Carl Torbush was going to call blitz. And if he handles that cleanly, Coleman, the shovel pass, he may go. But Jackson Appel comes up from his safety because of that hesitation. I really like that call by Spence. You know what you're going to get.
And we've completed a quarter. College football will return after this message and a word from our ABC stations. You're watching ABC Sports Championship Television. Who's back? And they are going to put the rush on in the end zone. He gets rid of it and a good kick. It'll be handled at the 46-yard line. The 40, 35, 30, two blockers in front. Touchdown, 10, 5, touchdown! Chansi Stuckey takes it in. Welcome back, everybody. Had a good one in the first half. Clemson, a 47-yard punt return by Stuckey that you just saw. Interception that was picked up by Sergio Gilliam and returned. A touchdown A&M had lost on a penalty. Big plays in the first half. Ed, what'd you see?
Well, you saw a lot of missed opportunities for Texas A&M. The halfback pass by Jason Carter, a little underthrown. Daquan Mobley drops it. They have to settle for a field goal. Offensively for Clemson, I think you see exactly why Tommy Bowden made the change. Not a lot of yardage, 123 passing yards, which you said was kind of secretive for Charlie Whitehurst, but you see them starting to get into a groove where they kind of lull you to sleep. It's a really good package by Rob Spence.
So they've done both of these teams kind of feeling not only each other out, but also themselves as to who they are as a team here in game one. Probably going to see some more of that here as we get set for the second half. And ready to go. Clemson had won the toss. They deferred, so they're going to get the football. Start the second half. Clemson would love, dearly love, to pick up what would be an underdog win here if they could get it. Richie Bean is ready to do the kicking. Coleman, Gaddis are deep. Coleman is standing right at the goal line, and that's where he's going to take it. Up to the 10, the 15. Boy, there was a lot of daylight there. Up to the 25-yard line, our Pacific Life game summary.
Well, just an excellent, excellent special teams play by Clemson. They came after the punt, and then everybody who came after it came, set up the picket fence for the touchdown, and then Courtney Lewis runs it in on what was over a 90-yard drive, every single yard gained on the ground. And Texas A&M, if they're going to contend for the Big 12 South, that's got to be a big guy, Courtney Lewis.
And they've got to come back here as Clemson's got the lead to start this second half. Charlie Whitehurst with Reggie Merriweather in the backfield behind him, as Whitehurst was 13 out of 10, 123 yards in the air, and it'll be carried to the line of scrimmage, and that's going to be it for Reggie Merriweather as Jackson Appel moves in and puts the hit on. First half stats that have made a difference in this football game.
Right there. Time of possession. Clemson last year was the offense. Their motto was three and out.
Yep.
Ty Hill, the cornerback, told us, you know, he just wants to see anything get established so they can rest. And that's exactly what Clemson has done. It's not been very flashy. A lot of people probably a little surprised. I mean, Tommy Bowden has always been kind of a flashy offensive guy, not calling the offensive plays now. Rob Spence comes in from Toledo, and they're leaving their defense off the field.
Second down and 9, man in motion with four receivers available. They look over the middle on the slant pass, incomplete at the 35-yard line. Would have been an up for the first down. Stuckey unable to hang on to it. Let's check in with Susie Schuster. Susie.
Well, Gary, I spoke to Dennis Francione, and he just said that he's deflected the blame from Reggie McNeil. He just said, clearly we've had a lot of drop passes, but that he's going to get back into the rhythm. I asked Tommy Bowden, well, what do you think about that? He said, look, this kid's trying to win the game for them. He's a little tight. Preseason honors come with jitters. You know, as for his offense, he loves how his guys are adjusting to this new offense. He said, look, we're playing it relatively simple, but no drop passes and no penalties. He says that's the most important thing to him. That's what makes him happy, guys.
And understandably so. Stuckey in motion over there to the right. And looking and surrounded, and down he goes. That is Chris Harrington out of Houston, Texas, a sophomore. The defensive end moved in and put the hit on.
Charlie's got to get rid of this ball. He just stands in there too long. You got the clock going, 1,002, 1,003. This is not terrible blocking. You know, that's the second time tonight that we have seen Chris Harrington, the defensive end, just show unbelievable power. I mean, he just took the right tackle and threw him on the lap of Charlie Whitehurst.
So it'll be a punt coming from the 5-yard line. This is the first Clemson punt. Cole Chasen is out there to do the kicking. Averaged 40 yards per kick last year. Gets that one over midfield. And there it will be down at about the 48-yard line, where A&M will take it over for their first offensive series, a 31-yard punt.
I want to go back to what Susie was talking about, her conversation with Tommy Bowden. You know, that's just been, he's been harping on that, the turnovers and just establishing any kind of running game. And we saw early on, the offensive line for Clemson just did not look comfortable. They didn't look good at their angles. They were jumping off sides. They had a new cadence they weren't used to. They weren't used to how the plays were being called. This has to be so pleasing to Tommy Bowden to see the progression they made through the beginning of the first quarter until the second quarter, and now good field position for A&M to
see how A&M responds. McNeil's got five receivers, looking back again to the weak side flats, and that's going to be incomplete. Now, we've seen A&M try that That was Mobley again, the intended. They flood one side and pass back to the other, but it hasn't been very effective.
Reggie McNeil, you know, Tommy Bowden may have hit it on the head. Maybe trying a little too much. There's a lot of expectations on this young man, although he's a senior. You know, we still have to remember that these are college guys, and they read the press clippings, and they know that. And let's not forget that he is competing against, in his own state, another pretty great quarterback for just all Big 12 honors, much less All-American honors.
He was a 58% pass completion quarterback last year, and you saw he's only had the 4 for 12 in this game. And I'm not sure the discussion started on the other side. May have been an eligible receiver and an eligible player out on the field. And that was the call. Boy, the penalties have hurt.
Ineligible receiver, number 54, downfield. 5 yards, repeat first down.
I'm not mistaken, though. Wasn't that ball thrown behind the line of scrimmage?
Well, I thought it was.
Yeah, so did I. In college football, linemen are allowed to go downfield as long as the ball is thrown behind the line of scrimmage. It looked to me like it was a screen to Daquan Mobley.
That was the discussion. It is a first down and 15. Ball is moved back to the 44-yard line. Again, McNeil will work out of the shotgun. 3 receivers to the near side. That's where he's looking, down the middle. That is incomplete. And was that ever close?
Yeah.
That was in and out of the hands as C.J. Gattis was back on the coverage. But that ball went right through the defenders. Susie, who you got there?
Well, I happen to have Ricky, Regina, and Stephanie McNeil. And let me ask you right away, you've watched every single one of your kids' games since he was 4 years old. Are you more surprised by the drop passes, or are you more surprised by his pick?
I'm more surprised of the pick and the drop passes. I mean, you know, the guy's got to just catch the ball. You know, he's putting the ball in there, they just got to catch it. For us, the pick, you know, we can overcome the pick. You know, they just scored 3 points off of it. So, you know.
What's your assessment of how he's playing tonight? Do you think he's got some jitters from all the preseason honors and the attention?
No, I don't think he have any jitters or anything like that. I just think that the team is defense cut down on the penalties and catch the passes when they throw them to him, you know?
Well, Carter caught that one, but not much yardage on it as he got it right at the line of scrimmage and a game about
the game before they Hugh. How nervous are you watching this game?
Well, in the beginning I was real nervous, but I'm nervous more than he's never nervous, but I'm okay now, you know, because I know it's going to be okay.
I know you're afraid to fly. You're driving to every single home game that this year, is that right?
Yes, and I'm driving to all the out of town
games. Road game.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. I don't like flying, that's right.
Second down and 5, and the defense rises to the occasion. That is Sergio Gillum, who's having himself quite a football game. A loss of 4. That's the player who had the interception earlier for Clemson and the big return. The mom and dad may be a little more concerned after this series.
And Gillum, a guy who had to replace a pretty good player at Clemson, Justin Miller. Interception on the play in the zone coverage, and they were battling it back and forth, weren't even sure if Sergio was going to start this ball game, and I think he's starting to prove to the coaches that they made the right decision.
Third down conversions. Texas 2 out of 5 in the first half out of the shotgun. McNeil on a third down and 9 at the 40-yard line. McNeil looking near side again. The short pass at the 40, and that's it. 5-6 defenders covering on Urban Taylor. And that was Anthony Waters, who came in from the middle linebacker position to lead the charge. There's Waters, and he got a lot of help.
Well, Reggie's just not himself tonight, Gary. I mean, he's got 2 receivers running down the middle of the field. This is Carter, just wide open. The safety does not come down. That's Mobley. He also had Schrader running the exact same route on the other side of the field, and he was open. And Reggie just not himself. He's not seen the field. He's got to settle himself down.
Gattis is back for the punt on the 4th and 8. He's going to let it go, and A&M's going to get the bounce. Inside the 5-yard line, down to the 3. So a good kick, good coverage. Stephen McGee going in to down it, a 36-yard punt, tough territory for Clemson when we come back. Clemson with the 16-10 lead over the favorite Texas A&M. Thursday night, ABC starts the football season with a spectacular celebration. Rolling Stones, Green Day, Santana, many more. It's NFL opening kickoff presented by Sprint. Tom Brady, champion Patriots, take on Moss and the Raiders. Monday night football, special Thursday night edition at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC. A first down and 10. And Clemson will pass out of their own end zone to the 10. That's going to be a first down up to the 15. Now there's a gutsy call, a 12-yard gain to Chansi Stuckey.
Well, that's the nice part about this offense, Gary, is they can do so many things. Again, like Jackson Appel said, it looks kind of boring. And then you get a little play like this. Stuckey comes in motion, and this essentially turns into a toss sweep. I mean, the ball was thrown forward, so it'll go into passing yardage. But if he drops it, big deal. You know, it's second and 10, and now you're no longer in your bring-it-out offense. Now you're into your full complement of plays.
Charlie Whitehurst, he's got Kyle Browning in the backfield, and that's who he goes to. And that will be a loss as A&M with Red Bryant leading. The All-American freshman, Bryant, now the sophomore, 6'4", 320, big presence.
Well, and you're going to have great numbers in this offense. The one thing that Tommy Bowden really liked when he looked at Rob Spence's quarterbacks was how efficient. The last 4 years, Rob Spence's quarterbacks have been in the top 20 in the country in efficiency. And it's throws like that. You know, those aren't really difficult throws, although that was a great throw because it was right on time and led the receiver. But you're going to get insanely high completion percentages with the shovel passes, all of those little bubble screens. It's just so hard to defend.
See the audible call by Whitehurst. They go straight up the middle. And they'll be close to the 20-yard line on that. Still short of a first down.
And then they bring in the wrinkle of the tight ends. Now, Tommy Bowden's going to have to go out and recruit some tight ends because he said if you used to want to see my tight ends, you had to come out to pregame to watch them run around. But these guys will try to outflank the defense. So if the defense is set one way, they'll bring either Downer or Williamson over to the side, and they become the lead blocker. It's really kind of an H-back. This is an offense that goes way back to the Hogs with Joe Bugle and the Redskins. And yards per game, they were 100th in the country. They're going to be a lot higher in the national ratings this year with this type of offense.
Third down and 6. Clemson has the football deep in their own territory and looking deep down on the out pattern. Caught! And out of bounds at the 37-yard line. Curtis Bayham got it, the senior wide receiver. And again, Charlie Whitehurst has made the big plays when needed in the air.
Well, that's the thing. You do those little simple things with the swing passes. But this is just a great throw. Gets there on time. There's a cornerback, Jones, off the side shoulder of Bayham. Bayham, a guy that, you know, he's a senior, but they didn't talk that much about him. But obviously, Charlie has a lot of confidence in him.
19-yard gain will give a first down and 10 to Clemson. And as important, they're hanging on to the football. This one is going to be scooted up to about the 42-yard line. We've had Merriweather, Browning, Coleman, and Davis, the four running backs, all involved in this game. Browning, that time, number 28 on the carry, and a second down and 7.
Doesn't feel like this is the first time in the game that one of the teams has actually taken some momentum. I mean, it was kind of back and forth, make some mistakes. There was the one great punt return and the nice touchdown by Courtney Lewis. But this seems like Clemson now is really taking control.
Again, wide receivers near side. They work out of the shotgun. Whitehurst gets some protection. Coleman a good block. Near side at the 45, the 50, as the flats ended up being wide open that time. Again, Curtis Bayham coming the other side, taken out by Carpenter.
And now you see where Rob Spence, when I was asking him where he built this offense, it started when he was coaching for Mark Duffner at Maryland. They used to do the run and shoot. And that was a little sprint out by the quarterback, so he's not sitting right behind, and he just sets up right behind the offensive tackle. It's not a boot. Just move the pocket a little bit, and your quarterback better have a strong arm if he's going to throw that. And Charlie's got plenty of arm.
Again, without the huddle, first down and 10 as they've moved the ball into A&M territory at the 49-yard line. Whitehurst staying with that tight end, jockeying back and forth here. Again, they screen it to the near side. A little room up to the 40, 35, and inside the 30, Aaron Kelly. Kelly was not listed on the depth charts, but has come on and been a primary receiver and a 22-yard gain.
And again, Charlie Whitehurst, has to be having the time of his life right now. After the horrendous season he had last year where just everything was asked of him and he ended up forcing it, he said, the game sped up so fast sometimes I had no idea what I was seeing. Now he's just playing catch with his friends.
And Aaron Kelly's another freshman who's become a receiver here in his first game. Another first down for Clemson. Carried to the near side. Little hurdling at the 25-yard line. And Coleman's been doing a lot of that in this game. Coleman taken down after the game by David Ross, the tackle.
Talked to Charlie Whitehurst about what he felt like he had to do this year after such a bad 0-4.
I think it's good and bad. I have a lot to prove. It was real good this time last year. I've got some critics now, and I'm trying to prove them wrong.
And so far in this game, he's doing it. Clemson, the underdog in this game with a 16-10 lead, 6:40 to go here in the third. It'll be a second down and 5. Coleman again on the carry, but not this time. Good coverage as they came in from behind. Again, that's David Ross, who moved in from the opposite defensive end position.
Well, quarterbacks always get more credit when you're winning and more blame when you're losing. And these throws underneath to these receivers, and don't act like it's simple. I mean, it's an easy throw, but the timing is so important. And that was the one thing that Rob Spence said, because this is such a timing-based throwing offense. Just because the guy's close and there's nobody really covering him, you have to hit him in stride and in time. He said, I'm so thankful that Charlie's here because he picked it up so quickly in the spring.
Third down and 8. Big third down play to keep a drive alive here. Whitehurst is straight drop, looking to the near side, open at the 20. That's not going to be enough for a first down, but a flag is down way over on the other side of the field at about the 10-yard line. So Whitehurst completes it. That was back in the defensive backfield where that flag went down. It would not be enough for a first down. It would bring up a fourth down and about 4. But let's see what the penalty is. A&M, most likely it's going to be against them. It is. And all of a sudden, these penalties for A&M, they've already lost a touchdown in the first half because of a penalty, and now it's cost them twice on this drive by Clemson.
Holding. 23 of the defense of an eligible offensive receiver throwing it down in which a legal forward pass across the line of scrimmage. The penalty carries an automatic first down.
That was War and Peace explaining that. Ronald Jones up top right here. And you can't blame him. He slipped, he fell, and he tackled the receiver. Let me tell you something. You say, oh, bad play. That's a really bright play by Ronald Jones, because if he doesn't tackle Bayham, Clemson is not on the 15-yard line. Yeah, Charlie would have seen Whitehurst was looking that way and had to come back down because Bayham got tackled.
First and 10 for Clemson at the A&M 15-yard line, and movement in the line by A&M again. We'll see whether or not they were pulled off. A long count by Charlie Whitehurst. And right now, things are not going A&M's way. And this is the best drive we have seen by Clemson in the football game.
A lot of hands on hips, Gary.
Prior to the snap, contact, number 97 defense. 5 yards, still first down.
Dennis Franchione said that they may try to play as many as 9 defensive linemen. They might want to start getting some guys with some whiter shirts out there, because these guys are getting worn out.
That's 8 penalties and 65 yards assessed against A&M. It was the exact opposite situation last year when A&M rolled over Clemson in the game. Right now, Clemson's got a chance to take it in. It's a first down and 5. Coleman is in the backfield. 2 receivers split to the right side. Whitehurst on the kick puts him in motion. Fakes it one way up the middle. Coleman on the carry goes inside the 5 to the 4. Good action in the backfield on the fake on the second man through.
Well, we've been talking a lot about Courtney Lewis for Texas A&M, how he was injured last year. Dwayne Coleman, who was the top rusher at Clemson in 03, battled a bunch of injuries last year too. Watch this little stutter step at the line of scrimmage. It's really nice running. And 4 running backs for Clemson. They have just a tad bit of depth. They've all been great.
I mean, they're really running the ball hard here. So it'll be a first and goal. Ball spotted at the 3-yard line. First and goal. Coleman again up the middle. A big push. And A&M will shove that pile back the other way. May have been a gain of one or may have been right at the line. We'll wait for the unpiling to take place. Michael Bennett in there on the hit. Want to remind you, time permitting, we'll have the Thrifty Car Rental postgame report. John Craig and Aaron will be along. Stay tuned. Highlights and analysis from this big day of college football. And there's been lots of it and a few upsets along the way.
Clemson last time was down in here. They stumbled, bumbled. They tried to run it inside. This formation leads me to believe they're going to try it again. I start to get the sense that Rob Spence might be just a little bit stubborn as well.
Yeah, Coleman and Jackson in the backfield. Kapweider's looking into the end zone, and the receiver, it went behind him, and he could not get turned around. Cole Downer. And that's what that was for him, a downer. He was wide open, but the pass was on the backside.
And Cole Downer, it's hard to tell what Charlie was expecting. Was he expecting him to sit down or continue to go with the roll? You would think most of the time you want him to sit down, because if he continues to run, there's people in the way, and that's exactly where he threw it. I think that's a miscommunication. I think Downer was supposed to stop right at the goalpost. He kept running with the quarterback. When you have that action, if the guy stops, all the defenders go by him. He's wide open.
95 yards on this drive, but no points yet. It is a third down and goal. Third down and goal inside the five. Coleman again on the carry and is not going to get there. This A&M team on the goal line, David Ross has been involved in a number of the tackles, the 299-pound senior.
Kick it. I like aggressive calling, coaching as much as the next guy. Go up nine. You've got the momentum. Everything is on your side. Kick this ball. And they're going to boo, but this is absolutely the right decision by Tommy Bowden.
It is a fourth down and goal from the one. Whitehurst comes out. We'll see if this comes back to haunt Clemson in this game. It's twice now. They've been down once at the two-yard line, once now at the one, and did not get a touchdown.
And it hurts you as a coach to do it. I wouldn't put it past old Coach Bowden as for a fake, but I think they'll kick it here. This is the right decision, but it's
this
a swing of about eight.
Dean up and another one. He is four out of four. Field goals of 21, 21, 25, and that one of 18 yards. So he's making a difference in this game. 19-10. The Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend on ABC, brought to you by Allstate, proud sponsor of the Bowl Championship Series. Taco Bell, think outside the bun. Nissan, who reminds you to shift the way you move through the world. And IBM, helping companies innovate in a demanding world. 14 plays, 96-yard drive. And
three
push him up, Tiger.
Yeah, but he's only got to do three. Well, 19, I guess he doesn't for all of them.
Yikes.
That's twice. Clemson has been inside the two and come away with six total points instead of 14.
Chad Dean, who's kicked the field goals 4 for 4, will do the kicking. Mobley and Carter are back. That'll be handled on the near side by Jason Carter. 10, 15. Carter's got room. 30, 35. Got blocking. And all the way up to midfield. What a great return. And Chris Clemens, the freshman, had to take him down the last man, and Carter's had a big football game for A&M.
And this is one thing that Dennis Franchione spent so much time during the spring and the fall improving. They were the worst overall special teams team in the entire Big 12 conference last year. And they worked so hard on these returns. And McNeil, who's struggling, said, yep, give us all you can, Jason. We're going to need it.
Carter last year had 330 yards on 18 kickoff returns. It is not uncommon. This is only the fourth snap for A&M this quarter, and there's only 2:50 left to go. So they need some time on the field offensively, as it's taken over the 45 by Courtney Lewis.
And A&M needed something to get going. These are their stats from last year. Dead last in net punting, second to last in punt returns. Dead last in kickoff. I mean, 15.7. That's horrendous. It's almost amazing when you look at their record, because special teams is obviously a third of the game. Being that bad, they were still able to win. That has a lot to say about Reggie McNeil's performance. But they needed something like this return to get them back focused in this game.
Now a second down and a two as they are in Clemson territory. There's the little pitch wide side, first down, down to the 40 and the 35 yard line and out of bounds. And that's Courtney Lewis again, the junior on the fly. His coach describes him as a runner, as a balloon with the air let out of it. Once he gets the football, you don't know what direction he's going to go in, and he just kind of zigzags all over the field.
Does he make that funny noise?
I hope not.
I hope not.
No. Either. No, he'd never live that down if that happens.
You know,
actually,
if he wasn't healthy right now, he would not have outrun Antonio Clay that time. Clay had him, had an angle on him and everything, and the young freshman could not keep up with the speed.
34-yard line. They bring the man in motion. It is a first down and a 10. McNeil, again, decides to keep. And McNeil will take it down to the 25-yard line. We thought we would have seen more of him keeping the football than we have so far in this game.
And I like what Les Koenig has done, the offensive coordinator. Susie finished up talking to Reggie's parents, and they both said to her that, you know, we think that he's a little nervous, that there's so much riding on this game, and we've never seen him this tight in a ball game. And I think what Les Koenig is doing, they're finally sensing that. Coach Franchione said that a little bit to her, to Susie, coming into half, and I think that Coach Canning is now saying, you know what, let's put him in his comfort zone. We know he's comfortable running. Let's get him settled down with the ball in his hand.
Second down and one out of the shotgun. He'll take it to the near side, his 25th start, looking for the first down, and just about got there as he carries that thing out of bounds. But they're moving the football. Let's take a look at the Nissan drive summary. It was the last one for Clemson.
Obviously not driving a 300Z down around the 2 yard line.
They do get points out of it, but we'll see if those two chances inside the two come back to haunt them. Right now they've got the 19-10 lead.
Yeah, but this is exactly what A&M's doctor ordered. Reggie McNeil has not been very good throwing the ball tonight. He threw it. I mean, he threw four interceptions all of last year. Just made it a terrible throw to Boone Stutz, the big tight end, overthrew the ball, was intercepted. And he's had some balls dropped. I mean, let's be fair in that.
But he's had his best season last year against this team, and if it doesn't improve, he may have one of his worst games in his career here tonight. But there's plenty of time left here, and this talented running, throwing quarterback can change a game in a heartbeat. He was the one trying for the first down, and he got it on that last carry. While they move the chains back, we'll check in again with John Saunders in New York. John.
Well, Gary, thanks a lot. Georgia Tech facing Auburn. As you know, P.J. Daniels just powers his way in from 2 yards out. Tech now leading 17-7. Remember, Auburn didn't drop one all of last season. They're almost at halftime there. Gary.
Well, we'll see how many of these we're going to have where the scores are against the team that's got the ratings. Minute 18 left to go here in the third. A first down and a 10. Good field position.
Watch the angle. Get it out of the quarterback's hand. You've got the outside linebacker Maurice Nelson right there. A little bit of a stiff arm, and he picks up two instead of losing five. This is a special player.
Sergio Gilliam came up to knock him away. It'll be a second down and eight. Balls at the 22-yard line. They H it up a bit here. There's the pitch to the 20. Great coverage and blocking. Five and down to the three. Jason Carter, Mr. Pass, throw, kick, and everything else, continues to impress in this game. Yes you did, all the way down to the three.
And again, this is right out of Urban Meyer's playbook. Not take anything away from Texas A&M, because I would copy it too, but Carter comes in motion. He played quarterback in high school, so he's used to being in the backfield. That's not a lot of receivers would not feel comfortable doing that, and that much speed on the edge with both McNeil and Carter. Who do you defend?
19 on the play, first and goal from the three. They've taken it down the field. Reggie McNeil turning it, trying to go outside tackle, gets to the one, and maybe even inside the one, but not in. It'll bring up a second down and goal, just shy of the goal line, denied by Jamal Fudge, one of their leading tacklers from last year.
Well, if you're not throwing it well and you're Texas A&M, thank goodness you have some guys who can run it and a big, powerful offensive line. Exactly zero pass plays during this drive.
Pretty amazing, isn't it?
Guess what they're going to do on second and goal.
Pass, right? I don't think so.
No, I don't either. Not this power eye formation.
They've got Lewis and Alexander, two running backs in the backfield. Take a look at that formation. Straight T. You don't see that very often. McNeil on the pitch. Walked that one in, Bubba. That's a touchdown. No question, Courtney Lewis. Nobody remotely near him. And A&M has all of a sudden quieted the 77 plus thousand here and got themselves right back into this game.
10 or 15 years ago when they started allowing really, really good athletes to play quarterback, you know, they always used to just let these big stiffs stand back there in the pocket.
That looked like he was
changed
another game.
Yeah. It just changed the whole complexion of trying to defend a team like Texas A&M. You take away one dimension or it's not working, then you just go to the option game, and it looks easy.
Pegram puts it up, and that is good. We've completed three quarters. A 51-yard drive all on the ground after Carter's 49-yard kickoff return. More coming up after this message and a word from our ABC stations. We go to the fourth, Clemson 19, Texas A&M 17.
Goodness, that's a live ball, son. You better cover it. Bounced off the shoulder pad and into the end zone. Marcus Furman going over in the corner could let it go, and it might very well have brought him out to the 35. The Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend on ABC Sports is brought to you by Allstate, a proud sponsor of the Bowl Championship Series. Taco Bell, think outside the bun. Nissan, who reminds you to shift the way you move through the world. And IBM, helping companies innovate in an on-demand world.
Been a long time since Palko and the offense have been out on the field, hasn't it?
Certainly has. They've had what? They haven't had a possession in this quarter. Ball is flipped outside to Greg Lee. Lee looking for a little help, but gets a lot of punishment. First, he was tackled, and then somebody ran over him. Maurice Crum.
You know, right now for Pittsburgh, you got to just play to your strength. That is Greg Lee receiving, Tyler Palko passing. Forget about the running game now. Bring in your receivers and let number three take over. This is a tall order, obviously, but it's your only choice.
Second down and seven from the 23. Thrown underneath, that'll work. That's a first down. Pass complete to Tim Murphy, and the football moves out to the 9-yard line. So move the chains, and here's John Saunders.
Keith, Texas A&M trying to climb back against Clemson. Reggie McNeil pitches the ball to Courtney Lewis. Good decision because he just trots in untouched. 19-17. Now the Tigers' lead is down to under a field goal. Keith.
There are a lot of folks think Aggies could win the Big 12 this year. They better get on their horse. Palko hadn't found anybody to throw to. Remember, he's got a dreadfully sore right hand, but he keeps it out of pain's way and picks up about 3 yards. Tomorrow, Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Week.
Out here. Well, first, let us apologize. We apparently have lost audio at the game between Clemson and Texas A&M. Clemson with a 19-17 lead as A&M has just come down. Courtney Lewis on a one-yard touchdown run. Charlie Whitehurst now trying to lead Clemson back down the field.
Well, you know, it was a very important series that A&M had answering the long drive that Clemson just put on the board. So for A&M to come back in their defense, at some point, A&M's defense is going to have to make a play because Charlie Whitehurst, now that he's off the field, that is a big, big blow to Clemson's offense.
And what set that play up and what allowed Texas A&M to go down and have that drive was the exact thing we talked about halftime, the thing that they weren't very good at last year, and that's special teams. Set up by a big return, it shortens the field. When you have a football field that's half as long as it could be, by special teams plays, it's much easier for the offense to go down and score. That is what Texas A&M needs to do. That's what's keeping them in this ball game.
Judging from what the trainer is doing to Charlie Whitehurst, he took a blow to the head. And that's usually the type of check they do if possibly you had a concussion.
Third and four, the Clemson Tigers have really been good at getting to the perimeter. And again, they do.
Apparently, we have recovered the audio at the Clemson-Texas A&M game, so let us return there now and Gary Thorne.
Yeah, they got a good one, Gary. Wow, this young man, I think he's going to be okay. True freshman, Douglas High School. Yeah. You know, we had a freshman when I was a senior at the University of Washington by the name of Kaufman, Napoleon Kaufman. He ended up being a pretty good pro. But really I remember good. When he was a freshman, whenever he got the ball, the entire stadium went silent. You're starting to get that here where people say, oh, number one's got it. We better just walk.
First game.
Yeah.
20-yard okay. gain. We apologize for some audio problems we're having. That one is carried. Proctor, great fake. Up over midfield and out of bounds in A&M territory at about the 45. Proctor with a tremendous fake pulled the A&M D all the way over to this side of the field.
Well, and he's only got three pass attempts in his entire career. He should have made it four. I'm not going to knock him for running. He picked up nearly 8 yards, but Bobby Williamson, the tight end running the drag route, was standing there waving, I'm open, I'm open. You can't blame him. He picked up the yardage, but
how fast is his heart beating? Sitting over there as a backup yeah. quarterback, 7 snaps all of last year. A new offense that's been instituted out of Winter Park, Florida, the junior.
He's been so patient, waiting his turn.
Second down and three. He kicks for the man in motion. Only one wide receiver to the near side. They go straight up the middle on the handoff, looking for the first down, and looks like they probably got it. That's James Davis again, the freshman on the carry.
Well, we've already seen what James Davis can do to the outside, and typically young running backs with that much speed, you expect them to kind of be slashers, and you know they're always trying to take everything to the house. What I've been so impressed with James Davis is when he gets near the line of scrimmage and there's 1 or 2 yards to be had, he just buries his shoulders and gets it done. This is a more veteran back than you would expect for a true freshman with the way he runs, the different styles of runs based on what he needs.
Whitehurst is getting ready on the sideline, a first down and 10, ball at the 42-yard line. Proctor, wide receivers each side, lone setback Merriweather. Hands off, 40-yard line, a gain of maybe 3 on that. James Davis stays in there and runs it. Let's check in with Susie again. Sue.
Well, Gary, I just spoke to Len Davis, who's the team doctor. He said he was a bit dazed and confused. He's shaking it off, and you guys were absolutely right. He is furious and can't wait to get back in the game.
I think it was an accident.
Yes.
Right? I mean, it was a tackle coming over the tackler over the top. And
I think, to me, because we met, you know, I've met Charlie a couple of times in meetings. He's such a competitive guy. And last year really, really bummed him out. And I think what he's upset about is here I'm having a great game at home, national TV, and I got to take a stinking knee to the helmet and go to the sideline.
Second down and 7, looking for the screen, set up at the 40. Little blocking, and he breaks away at the 30 and down to the 25. Stuckey. No matter what the outcome of this game, Chansi Stuckey is going to be one of the names highlighted when you look at what went on, and Proctor got it to him.
And it's funny because they kind of talk about Stuckey as their possession type receiver, you know? He's the guy we can trust. We know he's always going to be open. But watch the moves as he gets into the middle and then bounces back to his right. If not for Brock Newton finishing the play, this is 6 more points. For Mr. Stuckey, who already had the punt return for a touchdown.
25 receptions last year, 280 yards. And no gain on this one, right at the 25-yard line on the first and at 10. This is where A&M's defense has risen to the occasion. James Davis, who stayed out there, now as they've stopped rotating the running backs. Davis may have earned himself a full-time job here.
I don't think he's coming off. They're still going to check with Charlie. I think it's wise to leave him out for this drive.
He wants desperately to get back.
Yeah, but I think this is the right decision. Let's let the cobwebs go completely before we put him back in.
Second down and 10 at the 25-yard line. Clemson in A&M territory. Hand off again straight ahead, and it'll be up to the 18 or 19-yard line again. And now A&M is really stacking it in the middle, shy of the first down. Tomorrow, Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend at ABC will feature West Virginia Syracuse at 1:30. Monday night, the game of the year, ACC. It's number 9 Miami heading to Tallahassee, number 14 Florida State. College football's great interstate rivalry. Monday night, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, ABC.
Yeah, this ACC conference is no longer a basketball conference.
No.
I mean, Georgia Tech's down there giving Auburn everything they can handle. Boston College got a win today against BYU. And that's a pretty serious addition to this conference.
Big play, third down and 7, rolling. Proctor looking, end zone open, incomplete. Just out of the reach of LaDon Harris, who we've not heard from in this game, but in the four receiver set, he comes in.
Difficult throw, right-handed quarterback. He's been standing on the sideline for the last 3 years. He's got to square his shoulders and come back and just, he's got it. It's a touchdown if he makes the throw. Just a bit outside.
So they took it to the 1 field goal. They took it to the 2 field goal. They will now have it at the 39. Looking for another field goal here. 39-yard field goal. See if they can get it. 4 for 4 so far for Jad Dean. For Clemson. And a flag down. Kick is up. The kick is good. But the flag is in the Clemson backfield.
Had something to do with before the snap because they were ready to throw it right away. Yeah.
Illegal procedure. He's going to have to do it again. So that's going to back him up another 5 yards.
We have illegal formation. Yeah. 6 men on the line of scrimmage by the kicking team. 5 yards. Repeat fourth down.
Well, and that's the counting coach on the sideline. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They're missing this body right here, the tight end. Somebody, and there's one coach who's in charge of getting those people out there. He's got to count them on the sideline and say, we've got enough to go out there. That's a terrible mistake.
44-yard field goal. He was 4 out of 6 field goals between 40 and 49 yards last season. That one is up, and that one is good.
No big deal.
You need me to do it again?
Let's do it.
5 for 5.
He's going to have to ice his groin after the bowl game.
He is a junior, Jeff Dean, and another 3. Clemson now leads at 22-17. You're watching Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend right here on ABC. And a good one underway here in Death Valley, where Clemson is 300 wins, 114 losses, 15 ties. And a very tough place to play, as A&M is finding out. That kick will be back in the end zone and will be touchdown. A&M will have it at the 20-yard line, and we'll check in again with John Saunders. John.
Gary, time now for the Pontiac game-changing performance update. TCU pulls off the upset of Oklahoma, ranked number 7 in reason. Their defense got after it. Sacks and fumbles, recoverings. Nominate your Pontiac game-changing performance at ESPN.com. Keyword is Pontiac. TCU with the upset, 17-10 over the Sooners. Here.
John, thanks very much. Boy, that rattled the cages of the football world early, didn't it?
Well, you know Texas A&M knew about that.
Yep.
That's who they're going to be chasing, them in Texas for the Big 12 South. Of course, Texas Tech in that mix is going to be very good this year as well.
All right, Texas A&M with the football. McNeil's got room, 25-30. Look out here, 40. At midfield, only one to get him. And takes him down at the 30-yard line. Unbelievable. That is Ty Hill, the only man who had a shot. A 49-yard McNeil scamper.
Well, and it takes the reigning ACC 100-meter and 60-meter indoor champion, and Ty Hill coming out of the game. If Ty Hill's not on the backside of this, this is going the distance. Because Reggie McNeil is as fast as there is on this field at 4.28.40, and just nobody home. And it's the receivers, Gary, down the field. Yesterday, when we were talking to Daquan Mobley about going downfield and blocking, he said, when you have guys like Reggie and Courtney, you're not afraid to be downfield blocked because you know it's going to pay off eventually.
Big, big play because it eats up all that yardage and still half of the fourth quarter left. McNeil still got it. Nobody to option two. He'll be taken down at the line of scrimmage right there as Chris Clemens moves in on it. How about scrambling away, Reggie, as you just saw?
I love it. You hear the crowd. You making people miss. It's just that much more amped up about it. I mean, you out there making plays, your teammate celebrating with you, and you just, I mean, really, I get to a point I start laughing and smiling at people when they start trying to blitz or dropping off, and I'm able to run.
Yes, you are. Reggie McNeil back again looking to pass. He wants this one in the end zone. Man open! And touchdown! Chad Schroeder on the reception.
First pass call in about, what, 15, 20 plays?
Yep.
Yeah. Give a lot of credit to Les Keene. This is great. I mean, it was off of a fake option. Schroeder on the backside just running the post. Cradles that thing in.
Boy, he talked about hearing the cheering crowd. When you're on the road, what you hear is dead silence. That's what McNeil's getting out of this. Begram on for the extra point that would put Texas A&M up by two. It only took three plays to cover 80 yards. McNeil running for 49 and then throws this 31-yard touchdown pass. Chad Schroeder celebrating over there, his third career touchdown pass. And all of a sudden, for the first time since they were up 3-0 in the game, Texas A&M's 24-22 over Clemson. And a heck of a drive and done in a hurry. So again, Clemson now will have to battle from behind as Richie Beam will put the foot into it. And this one's going to be picked up at the 10-yard line. Short bouncing kick. Gattis trying to spin back the other way. Down, I think, at the 15 is where they will mark it.
As we wait to see if it's... Excuse me, Gary, if Charlie Whitehurst is coming out or if it's going to be Will Proctor. That was a decision time for Dennis Franchione after that touchdown. The card says, depending on the time in the game, and that's always a choice by the coach. When do you start using the card for the two-point conversion?
By the kicking team. 5 yards from the end of the run. First down.
And Dennis Franchione with 9 and change left, thinking there might be more scoring, went for one. But let's see if that later, that two-point conversion, assuming they would have converted it, would pay off. They'd be up 3 instead of 2.
The Whitehurst on the sideline. Charlie Whitehurst on one of the few times, in fact, the only time in this game where he's had to be the ball carrier. Here's what happened.
Took a knee right there. It was the left knee of the linebacker. Renuel Green came in and just, you can't even describe, Gary, unless you've been hit in the ear hole, it catches air and forces it into your ear. You can't even describe what that does to you. I've been hit in the ear hole before, and the football field actually turned on its side because my inner ear just gave way. Oof. And I wouldn't be surprised if that's exactly what happened to Charlie.
Proctor still has the helmet on. You saw Whitehurst had been throwing, and he's trying to convince the staff to let him come back in, but... Well, it doesn't look like that's going to happen. We're going to re-kick here after the penalty.
No, he has the looks of someone who's not going back in the ballgame right now.
So we'll re-kick it on the 5-yard penalty assessed to A&M. That was a short kick that was handled at the 10, but not great field position as the return. It only had brought it back to about the 20-yard line, so not much to lose here. Gattis is on the near side, as this kick will come from the 30-yard line. Bean, a line drive this time. It'll be handled back at the 7. Coleman Coleman trying to go right straight up the middle and better field position on the re-kick at the 33-yard line. A game that has seesawed back and forth with field goals mattering. Chad Dean has gone 5 for 5 for the Clemson Tigers in field goals, but Texas A&M has battled back. They are ranked 17th preseason, and Clemson had the lead after they fell behind 3-0 early. They went on top. Now Texas A&M's got it back. I'm Gary Thorne with Ed Cunningham and Susie Schuster and our crew here at Clemson. And a really good football game. The aerial shot from our friends at Outback Steakhouse. Proud sponsor of the Outback Bowl. Quarterback, the Outback Steakhouse airship, the Bloomin' Onions here with these great shots we're seeing from on high. And a very summer-like night. So Proctor will stay in. On the carry, we'll take it up to the 37-yard line. Proctor, the quarterback carrying, Green on the tackle.
Clemson has traded 7s for 3s twice. We mentioned they've been inside the 2-yard line. They've had first and goal inside the 10 a couple of times and not able to convert. And that could end up being the difference in this game. The new offense, it's been very good until it gets down inside the red zone. And then for whatever reason, I think sometimes a little too conservative play calling. One mistake by the tight end when Whitehurst had him wide open.
Second down and 5. Handoff is up the middle on the comeback, and that's going to be enough for a first down. Reggie Merriweather on the carry puts it away. And now we'll see. There's plenty of time here with 8:26 to go for Clemson to continue their ground game here. And that has been their game offensively tonight.
The one thing that Tommy Bowden was talking about with these other backs, we've talked a lot about James Davis, a young man out of Atlanta. Whenever a big recruit like that comes, and we've been saying they've had 4 backs to go in, he said, I have noticed a little more sense of urgency at practice with some of the older players.
That'll do it, won't it?
He sure will.
Cliff Orrell's come on into the backfield here as well as a fullback. Looking to pass, Proctor over the middle, completed at midfield. That'll be a first down up to the 44-yard line. Cole Downer. You see the tight ends. We talked about them being used. The 13-yard gain, our Pacific Life game summary.
Well, the second of Lewis's touchdowns was pretty easy on the option. Jad Dean, 5 for 5, and ties the school record. And the big story now, with Texas A&M getting the momentum back, Charlie Whitehurst took a knee to the helmet. And from the looks at it, it doesn't look like he's going to be back in this game.
First down and 10, ball at the 44. So the job now is Will Proctor in at quarterback, 2 receivers near side. He rolls with it. He's looking. He's going to carry. He'll go down after picking up about 5 yards. Proctor certainly doesn't look as though this is a job he's not ready to do.
Well, he's been 3 years in the wings behind Charlie Whitehurst. This would be the 3rd year. And the coaches said all along they would not hesitate to call the entire offense. He had a great spring. He had a really good camp. Looks like our first cramp of the night. That's not surprising.
That's Jason Jack, the defensive end. Proctor's now carried 3 times for 18 yards since he's come in as quarterback. We're in the 4th quarter, 7:10 to go. Texas A&M with the lead. Clemson with the football. The Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend, ABC, brought to you by Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Dr. Pepper, one taste and you can get it. Singular, raising the bar. Pontiac, official performance machines of the NCAA. And Pacific Life for insurance, annuities, and investments. Choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. And right now, Clemson fans hoping that their Tigers can succeed. As we've got a 2nd down and 4 at the A&M 38-yard line. Handoff, not going anywhere on that one. Line of scrimmage at best for Reggie Merriweather as he gets met by most of the linebackers, and Marcus Thornton, the junior defensive end, led the charge there. I've got to thank somebody. Down on the sideline, there's a state trooper by the name of Benji Ross who travels for security with his Clemson team. His dad runs the Minuteman Press, Danny Ross here. What a great father who helped me last night get ready for this football
game. What time?
Game.
About 3 in the morning?
About 7 o'clock, yeah. Staying open long after. I want to thank him, and I know he's watching, and his son's down there, a state trooper. Thanks for the help.
You had 15 baseball games this week.
That's
so
right.
You had to cram last night. Yeah.
3rd down and 7. Big 3rd down play, 41-yard line. Receivers each way slotted near side. Looking downfield. Bounced off the receiver's hands and incomplete. Bobby Williamson A big, big tight end tried to haul that in at 6'4", but that was overthrown.
Well, and Will Proctor's lucky that that big tight end got his hand up and made a stab at this ball. This is an interception waiting to happen. And the safety and a dropped off defensive lineman there because of the zone blitz waiting for that ball, and Williamson luckily finishes the play.
So fourth down and 7. That'll bring up the punting situation. And let's see where Cole Chasen tries to put this. Carter is back there and he'll do the fair catch. So that's where A&M will start. Now with 6 minutes left to go, the defense of Clemson has got to go to work to get that football back from A&M, with A&M leading it by 2. You're watching Dr. Pepper College Football Kickoff Weekend on ABC. Time of the essence.
Two big storylines late in the game. Charlie Whitehurst out, probably done for the night, got hit in the side of the head. Clemson has been inside of A&M territory 7 times, 0 touchdowns, all field goals.
And A&M's got the football, and they'll run it to the 15-yard line deep in their own territory, and this is where the Clemson D will try and rise up and stop them. Courtney Lewis on the carry. Lewis has had an impressive first game.
And this is where Vic Koenig, the new defensive coordinator, Tommy Bowden changed both coordinators coming into this year. This is where he's going to prove Tommy right or wrong. These guys need to stand up. If they don't stand up now, you get a feeling this ball game's over.
Second down and 8 for A&M. And they're at their own 15-yard line. 5 receivers. Back in the shotgun, McNeil. Near side. That is caught at the 20-yard line. Not enough for a first down. And it'll be spotted at the 19. Time permitting, we'll have the Thrifty Car Rental postgame report with John, Craig, and Aaron. Stay tuned. Highlights and analysis from all of the day's college football activity. An enormous third down play.
Listen, Reggie McNeil struggled terribly in the first half. The way they got him back on track was by running the option. I wouldn't even risk a throw here. He's so good with the ball in his hands. Sucks the defense in. Do something over to the right here. Bring somebody in motion and look at some type of option.
Third down and 4. McNeil taking a look. Didn't like it and asked for a timeout. So Texas A&M had 3 timeouts to use here. They'll use one of them because this play is too important to snap the football if you're not sure what you're going to do.
Now, emptying the backfield was a little tough to run the option.
Yes.
With no one back there to pitch it to.
Yes.
We're just talking about the struggles that Reggie had in the first half, and then Les Kanin, the offensive coordinator, went to almost a completely run-based offense. On this last drive, Reggie, if it's not for the ACC's fastest man, Ty Hill, taking it down, gets a touchdown. And then the very next play, on a fake option to the left, the safeties don't get enough depth because of the fear factor of Reggie running. He throws a post to Schrader coming from the backside.
Tremendous play done in a hurry. Reggie McNeil will know that if you win this, you did it on a day where you didn't have everything that you'd like to have going for you.
Well, and having that guy Courtney Lewis back and improved defense, maybe it doesn't have to just be the Reggie McNeil show this year for Texas A&M.
The 78,000 plus on end here, standing, trying to make some noise for their team. 3rd and 4. Aggies have it at their own 19-yard line.
Look how close they're huddled.
That was after the sideline meeting.
Yep.
Now the option is viable, as McNeil will have Courtney Lewis in the backfield with him. And he'll pull in the slot man as well. And here's the option on the pitch. Red missed tackle. They stop him at the 20-yard line. 3 yards shy of a first down.
And there's Ty Hill. He missed the tackle, but he slowed down the ball carrier enough. And they got outside. This is a play that has been killing Clemson all night long. Ty Hill missed it. What great pursuit from the inside of the defensive line. Gaines Adams, a guy who's been a little hot and cold. He's got a lot of ability.
He's learning that bandit position that he's taken over, and open he makes side. A big tackle. So now Clemson's going to get the football back. 3:56, providing no penalty happens here. The punt will come from the 12-yard line, almost blocked. And Stuckey's going to watch it take a bounce. Dangerous pickup, and carries it up over the 40-yard line to about the 42, where Clemson, with 3:40 to go and trailing by two, will have the football back. A 44-yard punt and a rather miraculous 6-yard return.
And Will Proctor will come back in. Charlie Whitehurst does not even have his helmet. His night is over because of the shot to the head he took. And you cannot get conservative. This offense has to do a bunch of different stuff. And Will Proctor, a junior, is ready to handle it all. He can make all the calls. He can make all the adjustments. Maybe not quite the thrower Charlie Whitehurst is, so you're not going to do a lot of stuff down the field, but you can still throw the little screens to the sideline. Some shovel passes do it all.
They've got time out of the shotgun. Receivers off the near side. Handoff. Really taken up to midfield. Boy, what a day for James Davis, the freshman, who has earned a spot in that backfield, and now at clutch time, he's there.
That's exactly the point I was just about to make, Gary. I mean, this is not the second quarter. They're at home, down by two, and you get the feeling this has to be the drive. This has to be the drive they get the field goal. And now we go back to that two-point conversion that Dennis Franchione decided not to do, went for the one. Now you're in Jadeen, where he can win the game, yep, or come close to win it, depending on what the clock does. I'd start eating some clock, too.
Under quarterback, they're going to go for the first down. Second down and one. Handoff straight ahead. Again, up to the 41-yard line. James Davis, an 8-yard gain. Tackle made by Brown. Davis Brown, the starting quarterback, Charlie Whitehurst, is watching from the sideline after taking a knee to the head. And Will Proctor, who had 7 snaps all of last year, the backup quarterback, is running the offense. It is a first down and a 10 from the 41-yard line. 3 tight ends, Downer, Williamson, and Hunter, are all in the game. A special news report now from ABC News.
Hey, Joe, if you're going to hold them,
It'll be a third down and four, ball at the 35-yard line. And for Clemson, maybe the play of the game. They got two shots at it, of course, here with only a minute 38 left to go. Looking for the first down, third down and four. Clemson trailing by a couple. And now a timeout is taken on the field.
Well, you're right at the edge. Jad Dean's career long last year against Miami, 48 yards. He missed a 52-yarder, which is the longest he's ever attempted in that same game. I just don't think you feel comfortable right now.
This would be a 52-yarder.
Yeah, he hasn't shown he can do it in the past. I think you'd want 7 to 10 more yards to be comfortable.
Will Proctor, third down and four. The handoff straight up the middle, and they got the first down at the 30-yard line. As the offensive line of Clemson just drives it forward. First down will keep the clock ticking here with a minute 23 left to go.
And I think if you're Clemson, and we go all the way back with 9:22 left when Dennis Franchione decided to go for one instead of two on the post pattern touchdown to Schrader. And sometimes you get caught up in the emotion, although Coach Franchione doesn't seem like somebody who get caught up in that, to know that, you know, this is one of those choose at times. We're up one in the fourth quarter. Should we go for two? He chose to go for one. It was in that tweener time where you're not sure if you should go for two or one. Obviously looking now like you should have gone for two.
First and 10. Davis has carried it all five plays. Davis again has got it, and again over the 30-yard line. Under a minute left to go. We welcome you back here. This is 24 seconds left to go. Clemson has the football in Aggie territory. It'll be taken down to the 24-yard line. They can use a timeout there in field goal range, and they will. So Clemson, with their backup quarterback carrying this team, and that's the leading runner, Davis. He has 7 straight carries on this series to move Clemson to within field goal range. Another field goal could win it. 16 seconds left to go, and the young freshman James Davis, along with backup quarterback Will Proctor, have become the stories for Clemson.
Davis just going over 100 yards, a true freshman, and the 2-point conversion after the touchdown to Schrader. They decided, Texas A&M decided to go for one. We wondered if they should have gone for two at that time. It was fairly early in the fourth. A lot of coaches think you don't start going for twos in a tight ball game until past the midway point. So it was kind of right on that line. He went for one, and now Jad Dean, if he kicks another field goal, breaks the school record with 6. And there, you got to figure right in his wheelhouse.
16 seconds remaining on the clock. Now the issue is, how do you play this? Davis, 7 carries, 33 yards in this drive. Just in this drive, he's been the one.
Well, I think, to me, third down with a timeout and 16 seconds left, I think you kick it here. Because if you have a bad snap, you fall on it, you call a timeout, you kick it again.
Texas A&M has 2 timeouts. Clemson has 1 remaining. Keep in mind, Clemson has never beaten Texas A&M. They are Texas A&M's 3-0. They're going to go for it. Third down and 4. They're looking for position here. Again on the carry, trying to get it right between the uprights at the 25-yard line.
They're going to make it the last play of the game.
Going to take the
chance.
Here's
the kick.
Wow. It'll be a 42-yard field goal from here. See, he's holding him. He wants the timeout. 6 seconds on the clock. 6 seconds remaining, and Clemson trying to upset number 17-ranked Texas A&M. Clemson unranked coming into the season.
You can call this an upset. A&M came in a 1-point favorite into this ball game.
What a football game to start here. Want to remind you, the Dr. Pepper College Football Weekend on ABC. We'll have West Virginia Syracuse tomorrow at 1:30 Eastern. That's tomorrow. And Monday night, Game of the year, ACC. It's number 9 Miami. Tallahassee's the site. Florida State's the opponent. That great interstate rivalry. Monday night at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. All on ABC.
Sorry about that, Gary. One of the changes in rules this year that anybody coming from more than 1 yard away from the line of scrimmage, if they leap, they can't land on anybody at the line of scrimmage. It used to be that they couldn't land on anybody in the opposition. Now they can't land on anybody. So you don't quite get the long run and the leap like you used to. This a longer field goal. It's out there at 42 yards or so. So you can think of it being a little flat. But Jad Dean last year was 12 of 15. He's 5 for 5 tonight. His misses from 52, 47, and 44. So at this range and in, he was perfect all of last year and tonight.
Trying to set a new school record to go 6 for 6 in one game on field goals. It is a 42-yarder. A chance for the game winner right here. Texas A&M lining up with nobody back, everybody in the line, and they'll take the timeout. Mm-hmm. So they want him to think about it.
Absolutely.
They still have another timeout to burn. And they've just burned it.
Fourth, third and final timeout.
You know, people say, well, why do you take him? You know, I always think take every one of them.
Yeah.
I'm nervous. Yeah. Of course he's nervous.
He gets to think about it for another 30 seconds to a minute.
And I love how no one's talking to him. Standing behind the nobody wants to jinx him. Nobody wants to be the guy who said something.
People are afraid to walk by him.
Yeah. Don't even be in his presence.
So for Dean, a chance to win this football game. I say that with one hesitation. There are 6 seconds still on the clock. There could still be a kickoff here, even if he makes it. With Texas A&M on top by 2, they are watching.
And that's why A&M took the timeout before. Clemson was going to wait till about 3 seconds, so it would be the last play. And Dennis Franchione called it at 6 seconds, so exactly what you're talking about, there still could be a kickoff in this game.
The lonely man, as most kickers are.
One is the loneliest number.
He looks like the lonely end of Army in those days gone by, who never got to come to the huddle. All right, here we go. Texas A&M had lined everybody up, not trying to get anybody to go over the pile. This is going to be a 42-yard field goal. 5 for 5 already for the junior. Jad Dean, snapper, holder. Good play by the holder to get that down. Kick is up, and it is good! What a play by the holder! Cole Chasen, that snap was low. He put it down, 2 seconds left. Clemson leads by 1.
They've had bad snaps all night. Cole Chasen, you don't expect the punter to have that great of hands. What a nice job getting that ball down. Oh, that's the hardest one too, when it hits the ground right when you're trying to catch it. If it's already rolling, you know you've got to scoop it and get it down. But that hit the ground right as Cole Chasen went to grab it, and he couldn't have said it any better.
Tommy on the sideline. Coach Bowden. Wow. 25-24. Whitehurst could not finish the game. Proctor came in for him after he took that knee to the head of quarterback. Might want to give that game ball to the holder. That was one big play. But guys, you love to see guys like that get recognition who rarely ever get talked about. It is not automatic that the snap and the hold always work.
Well, we've seen Nick Riddle, the snapper, almost throw it over Cole Chasen's head a couple of times on punts tonight. This time he tries to throw it through his hands on the ground.
6 for 6 for Dean.
That's a pretty good record.
Not bad.
How about a school record and a field goal to win the game? That's kind of a nice combination.
Now, do you kick this deep?
I don't. I squib it.
And that's what
with
A&M
this,
will play
time.
For.
Yeah, I'd squib it. And this is the old Cal Stanford drill.
Yep.
Used to hate practicing this. Run around. Everyone's throwing the ball around.
Yeah. Keep the band
keep
in the stands.
The field,
keep the band on the stands.
Especially the tuba player.
Two seconds left. Clemson leading by 1. Trying to win the opener at home against A&M, a favorite team. The roller is bounced at the 20-yard line. It'll be dropped back. Looking to make.
Somebody's got to be behind him.
There's nobody behind him. Carter running with it.
It's a forward.
It's a forward pass. It
you can't
matter.
Blame him.
Fumbles it. This game is over. This game is over. It is Clemson coming away with a win, 25-24. The goalposts automatically lowered before the fans take them down, and Clemson gets the game one win, at least a modest upset of Texas A&M, 25-24. Susie, if you can hear us.
I can hear you, Gary. Coach Bowden, tell me what the pit in your stomach was like watching that kick.
You stay in long enough, you lose some of those, you win some. I was just glad to win one.
What does this win mean to Clemson?
Well, it's a nationally ranked team to open the season. We've got a really difficult schedule, so this is a big one.
You had to be surprised when Will Proctor came in and played this game. What kind of kid is this, and how impressed were you with him?
Well, he's practiced really well, and he's paid his dues, and it really didn't surprise me.
I know you don't want it to begin, but are we going to have any kind of quarterback controversy here now that Will Proctor came in?
No. It's Charlie.
How's Charlie doing?
Yeah, he's doing. He's just getting knocked a little cuckoo.
All right, congratulations, Coach.
All right, thank you.
Gary, you better take it away.
Susie, you're going to get taken away. Be careful. What a win. Winning combination. Davis, 33 yards rushing in the final drive. Dean, a 42-yard field goal, is six of the game, a new school record. And Chasen with a tremendous hold to make that final possible. And Clemson comes away with a 25-24 win. We will come back to wrap it up. Another tombstone planted in Death Valley. And there's the final. What a game. What a start for Clemson as they get the 25-24 win with 78,000 on hand. And let's take a look at our Chevrolet players of the game.
Well, Reggie McNeil had a horrible first half, came back, played great and in the second half. But how do you not give it to Jad Dean? 6 for 6, a school record, and another tombstone, as you mentioned, going out by the practice field for Clemson.
And in recognition of the effort, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. Well, we were talking about the old tombstones that get planted here. There are teams who've been here before. Their names are many, and they are rich in football history, but they didn't win here.
If you beat a top 25 team at Clemson at home, you get to put a tombstone. Tommy Bowden has been through some ups and downs in his career. They still don't love him here, the faithful. This is the 8th time in 6 years that his team has beat a top 25 team. It's unbelievable how well he coaches in big games.
And they wanted their players to be able to believe in a new system. Nothing's going to help that more than a win, especially against a ranked team, and they have done that here. So that's going to do it. They celebrated the game coming down the hill, and they would leave continuing down that hill with a victory. Our final score by 1. Clemson got it. On behalf of all of us here at ABC, thanks for joining us. Ed Cunningham, Susie Schuster, and our great crew. I'm Gary Thorne. We bid you adieu from Clemson, reminding you Monday night at 8 Eastern. Don't miss Miami taking on Florida State. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports Championship Television. Roar Tigers, 25-24, the final.